Hi everyone, thanks for joining me today to learn about VS Code's implementation of a Jupyter notebook and all the great new features we have in store that will improve your data science workflow. Before we get started, let's go through some overview of today's walkthrough. So what will we be going over today? We're gonna go over what you will need, what is a Jupyter notebook, why all the changes, why is VS Code investing in these changes, and how to get started in VS Code and what features are supported for the notebook. So first things first, what will you need? In order to follow along today, you're going to need the VS Code Insiders build. This experience is not yet available in the stable build of VS Code. You'll also need the Python extension and the Jupyter extension, as well as Gather. You can actually install these extensions within VS Code itself by coming to the left side panel of VS Code and clicking on the Extensions tab. Here you can see all of your extensions that are currently installed, as well as the ability to search within the VS Code Marketplace. This is where you can grab those extensions I just mentioned. So what is a Jupyter notebook? A Jupyter notebook is an interactive programming and computational document that mixes executable code, equations, visualizations, and narrative text. It's the ability to have all four of these components within one document that has caused the Jupyter notebook to become the de facto tool for data science, where all of these are very, very necessary for data analysis and data exploration. Why the changes? So our previous implementation of notebooks used to be a web view, and now we're migrating towards natively supporting the IPYNB file type. What does that mean for users? That means users can now benefit from the integration with other VS Code extensions from our marketplace, such as Vim keyboard shortcuts or bracket colorizer. Those are two very popular ones. Users can also see improved notebook load times and a new modern design. So how did we get started with notebooks in VS Code? We can create a new notebook by bringing up the command palette. You can do so by holding down Ctrl-Shift-P if you're on Windows or Command-Shift-P if you're on a Mac, and typing in the keyword notebook. Here, the Create New Blank Notebook command has popped up, and we can select it. If you get a drop-down option, you can select Jupyter to create a new one. The first thing we'll want to do is make sure that we're working with the correct environment. So we can come down to the global status bar and select our kernel. I'm going to go ahead and activate my Anaconda-based environment for this notebook. I'm working with a Python cell, as indicated by the language picker in the bottom right, and I can click here to navigate back and forth between Markdown and a code cell. So earlier I mentioned a bit about the four components in a Jupyter notebook being executable code, equations, visualizations, and narrative text. Let me show you some basic example of those for some newcomers. So if I come to the input of the cell, I can go ahead and set the value of x to 42. I can run this cell by clicking the run icon to the left. The cell status bar is going to show me about how long it took to run. I'm going to add another code cell, and I'm actually going to print this value to view it. Here you see I'm getting some IntelliCode auto-completion suggestions, and to accept the suggestion I can hit tab. And as I continue to write and open these brackets, I'm going to get the function definition. This is really helpful because I don't have to go to Google and search what certain functions accept as parameters. It's going to pop up as I work and make it a lot easier for me to write my code. So let's go ahead and input x here and run it again. Now I could run it by clicking the icon once more, or I could use the Jupyter shortcut keys that are supported, such as Shift Enter. And here we have our output that displays 42. The cool thing about Jupyter notebooks is that I can actually override certain cells and run them out of order. So here I'm going to set x equal to 15 and come back to the second cell, run it once more, and the output has changed from 42 to 15. Let's talk a bit about those equations. I can add a markdown cell and double click to edit and enter something such as x squared and click shift enter to run it. This is going to render the LaTeX formula for me. I can also show you an example of something a bit more complex. And as you can see here, this has lit up red, which is indicating to me this is not a markdown cell. So I'm going to go ahead and switch it to markdown. There we go. Then let's do something maybe a bit more complicated. We can write out, for example, Euler's, oh, that's completed for me. Euler's identity. And here we have another LaTeX formula. So next on to visualizations. For the sake of time, I've gone ahead and copied the code that I wrote earlier. And I'm gonna go ahead and fix this actually. I have a little typo here, perfect. Now we have some of these values. I'm gonna go ahead and generate a histogram. I can run the cell once more. And this is a really cool example of when I'm going to have an input and an output. As you can see here, I've generated a really simple visualization. As you can imagine, these can become much more detailed and complex. And that last component from earlier is narrative text. Let's add one more markdown cell and show an example of narrative text. My first histogram. And those are the four basic notebook components. What other features are going to be supported in native notebooks? I'm going to migrate to the Titanic notebook, and this notebook predicts survivors based on input. Something that happens fairly often in notebooks, due again to their playground nature, is that the state of certain variables get lost as we start to overwrite and rerun cells. What we've created in order to alleviate that is the variable explorer. You can open it in the top right toolbar by clicking the icon. And what that's going to do is generate the list of all the active variables within this notebook. You can see the name, the type, the size, and the value. And this is an essential feature when it comes to debugging. You can watch these variables update live. You can also take a closer look at your data from the variable explorer by opening it in the data viewer. You can click the icon to the left of a variable. What that's going to do is bring up the data viewer. This will open up an Excel-like view of any tabular data you have within your notebook, and it makes it much easier to parse and understand. The filter row at the top can help you identify issues in your data that can then lead to steps to take to clean your data. So the data viewer will help you identify any issues within your data set much quicker, as opposed to writing code to identify issues and then writing more code to resolve them. Let's go back to our notebook and keep scrolling down to see what else is supported. Here we reached an IPy widget. Native Notebook supports IPy widgets, which are powerful interactive visualizations that can really help bring a notebook to life. These widgets usually have GUI elements such as buttons or sliders and can help turn notebooks even to a dynamic dashboard. Here we have Pandas profiling, which also has some button elements. An issue that can occur with IPy widgets or even other general notebook outputs is that they can get quite long and take up a lot of your window space. In order to make sure that users can focus on the most relevant output and input at the time that they want, we've introduced the ability to collapse both input and output. You can find it in the cell toolbar More Actions, and clicking it will bring the drop-down menu. You can then select Collapse Cell Output or Collapse Cell Input, and the shortcuts are located to the right. You can also double-click to the left of an output to collapse it. A collapsed output will be indicated by an icon to the left, and to reopen it, you can simply click it. Now we've reached the data cleaning portion. Let me go ahead and bring this a bit more into view. So here we have four code cells that are performing some data cleaning actions. And really piggybacking off of the last theme we talked about making sure users only have the most relevant code in front of them at the right time, we've introduced the collapse feature to the left of markdown cells. Clicking this chevron to the left is going to collapse all of those code cells under this markdown in order to ensure that if I'm scrolling through this notebook, I don't have to be distracted by any other code that is not relevant right now. Clicking the chevron once more will display those code cells. Now we're going to actually breeze through this next feature engineering section because the next thing I want to show you is at the bottom. So here towards the bottom, we can see two of my cells actually ended up in the wrong spot. This first cell is splitting inputs and outputs, and this second cell is splitting my testing and training data. I want to make sure that they're under the test train split markdown of my code. So what I can do is I can hover to the left of the cell and click to select this first cell. If I want to add other cells to my selection, I can hold down Control and click to the left of those cells as well. You can also use the traditional shift click. Now I can go ahead and hover over any selected cell, click and drag as indicated by the blue line. I'm going to place it under the test train split markdown cell. And now here we have the two moved cells in their correct location. Moving from here through the end are the models that we use to predict survivors: the naive Bayes classifier, the decision tree model, as well as a random forest. The last cell actually compares all of the accuracy scores of these models. So let's say we want to move forward with the one that was most accurate. That appears to be the random forest with all attributes. So to go back to that cell, I could scroll through the notebook and make sure I don't miss it again. Or I can actually go ahead and use the table of contents to navigate. To use table of contents in native notebooks, make sure you're in the File Explorer tab in the top left, and then come down to the outline section at the bottom left. Clicking that will then show you the markdown headers that are in your notebook, and you can use those to navigate through. As you can see, these are all the markdowns I have in my notebook, and I can click Random Forest to return to that spot. And here we have our Random Forest. If you're somebody who likes to see code in your table of contents, you can actually customize this via setting. So go ahead and bring up the command palette one more time and type in settings. You'll want to click the first option, UI, and type in notebook outline. Oops, outline, there we go. And then you'll want to enable the first setting that is show code cells. This will enable code cells in your outline. Let me show you what that looks like now. Heading back to the notebook, now my table of contents has all of my code cells. This is especially helpful if you're somebody who comments on your code a lot. Now back to our original task. We wanted to go ahead and move forward with the random forest model. So if I want to go ahead and do this today and clean up this notebook, I have a couple options. I can start copying and pasting cells into a new notebook and hope I don't leave anything important behind. Or I could be brave and try and delete cells within this notebook and hope I don't delete the wrong thing. So what we've introduced to alleviate this error-prone and tedious process of cleaning notebooks is an exploratory extension called Gather. Gather is indicated by the icon located in the cell toolbar here. And what Gather does is it's going to take all of the necessary lines of code that will actually generate a certain cell or a certain cell's output. In this case, we want the random forest output. So I'm going to go ahead and click Gather. What that's going to do is generate our gathered notebook. As I mentioned, this is only going to have the relevant lines of code to create that random forest model. It's not going to have lines of code that contribute to the decision tree or the naive Bayes classifier, for example. Now, you may not necessarily want your final output to be a notebook. You may want this production ready in a script. So you can go ahead and bring up the command palette and go ahead and select the settings option once more. Type in gather. And we'll want to look at the second option that allows you to gather your code to script. This way, instead of having a notebook, you will have a Python script that's ready to go. Let's go ahead and close these. And coming back to our original notebook, we've reached the end. Whenever you're happy with the state of your notebook and you're ready to share it, you can do so using the export feature, which is located in the top right toolbar. Clicking this icon will give you the three options for export. You can export to Python script for production ready, export to HTML, or even go ahead and export to PDF, all for easy sharing purposes. I hope you guys enjoyed seeing this quick walkthrough of the features we're enabling in native notebooks, and go try them out today. Follow me on Twitter at Claudia Reggio for more Jupyter Notebooks related announcements, and for any feedback or feature requests, don't hesitate to file issues on our VS Code Jupyter GitHub repo. Thanks!